You should be warned, the upcoming episode will be full of unfiltered, off-the-cuff discussion. As such, you should consider this your spoiler warning.
Hello, my name is Kyle.
My name is Ryan.
And when our powers combine, we form...
Experience Grind Podcast.
The podcast where we're not the only podcast. God damn it! I'm going to barrel through. We're not the only podcast with two nerdy white dudes talking about stupid shit that doesn't matter.
No, but we're just the ones that can't get it out.
No, we can't. We're going to ham fist that into our own mouths and fuck it all up. I just barrel through, whereas you, on your intros, you will retry until you get it perfect.
50 takes if it needs it.
I'm not a perfectionist. I'm... They don't call me old one take for no reason. I do have
I don't have a pun for that or something clever.
When I'm in the studio,
do people really call you one take?
I mostly refer to myself as old two take because usually when I record in studios, it takes me two takes to get my drum parts recorded. Then we can move on. But enough about me.
I was also called two take in college.
Because people had to take two takes at you to take in your face?
Yes.
Ooh,
that's good. I was trying to think of something clever to say.
No, today, Ryan, we're on the second episode of our Halloween specials. And by God, it feels good to talk about a fucking game again.
Yes.
This has been five episodes before we got back to games. Because we had all of our last special, which was Stoner Movies in September.
Yeah.
And now the first episode of our Halloween special was also a movie.
Mm-hmm.
But now we're into games.
I thought it was kind of nice. I enjoyed the break because games take so much longer to invest in than
a movie. Here's the thing. I thought it was nice. It was great. And I did not use any of that time to catch up on any of the other games we have coming up.
God, no.
Totally wasted that entire month for me.
Me too.
But
I will have you know, I did put 100 hours into a Dynasty Warriors game that month. So time well spent. You be the judge.
What Dynasty Warriors game?
It's Warriors Orochi 3. Which includes, like, Dynasty Warriors characters, Samurai Warriors characters, and, like, Chinese gods and stuff. And it's, like, more fantastical. Like, you're fighting Hydras and shit.
Okay. Is it this gen? PS4,
yeah,
Xbox
I'm playing on Xbox One?
One
right now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. In that vein, I'm very excited about the Berserk game coming out in that style. I think Koei Tecmo is making it as well. Are they the people that do Dynasties?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And they're doing a Berserk game, and I love Berserk, all things Berserk. So I'm very excited about that. So, I don't know. We'll talk about that, I'm sure. I played Dynasty Warriors 1.
Yeah.
And I liked it. The only thing I really remember is that, and you can tell me this because you just played it. I remember a character called Fukushima, but me and my buddies, we always called him Fukushima. And that's who we played as, and we just killed everybody.
I don't know the names. There are 160 playable characters.
What?
In that game.
That's
so,
more than a fucking Suikoden game.
Oh, yeah. There's like... 50 plus missions that are just like normal straight through missions, and there's like extra side missions, and like each mission you're unlocking 4 to 5 different characters.
Holy shit.
In this game, it's absurd how many people there are now. So I don't even know if there's somebody named Fukushima. I don't know.
Well, goddamn. That's a bummer.
Yeah.
I wanted to talk about that because I like Fukushima. I always called him Fukushima. That was the thing. Totally bastardization of the Japanese language.
Yeah.
That's what I do.
There's like a clever joke in there.
There's
like
something.
Somebody else also does a bastardization.
Yeah, that's Dave from Tadpog. He cannot say Japanese things.
Oh, no, I meant like I was going to go political with it or something, like make a big sweeping statement, not just call one person out.
We'll get to the political stuff later.
In Resident Evil 4, will we?
No, not in this. In a future episode. Wink! Serious hint drop. Although I think I already broadcasted everybody to expect something.
Oh, did you?
Maybe I did. Anyways, you just dropped the name. What are we talking about on this episode?
We are talking about Resident Evil 4 for originally the GameCube. And
yes.
Then a year later, the PlayStation 2. Mm-hmm. And then now it's on every current console.
I played it on Steam, yeah.
Yeah.
Just recently, because it's like an HD.
It is. I did not play the HD version. I went back to the old tried and true GameCube.
That's a very good version. It is.
It is.
Top 5 GameCube games of all time.
I think it might be the best. Yeah.
It's up there. GameCube's a bit of an underrated system.
Oh, shit,
system.
I played my hand. You don't know if I like Resident Evil 4 or not, but now you know.
All right, so here's the real challenge. Find me somebody that doesn't like Resident Evil 4. This is a game that's almost universally loved by almost everybody.
That's true, yeah.
I don't really know what we're going to say on this episode that hasn't been said 100,000 times, but we're going to have fun with it, and that's all that matters.
Yeah, that's why I took no notes, because I was like, well, you know, I don't have to be informational.
How many times have you played this game? Like
4, 5, yeah. Maybe? Which doesn't sound like a lot, but for a 20-something hour game, that's a bit.
I burned through. I got to the castle in the last 2 days. I think I'm at like 11-ish hours. Mm-hmm. But at this point, this is what I like about especially some of these Capcom games and Square games is learning the system and then gaming that system to your full advantage. And Resident Evil 4 is one that you can do that a lot in. Mm-hmm. I like to do that. I like, you know, the big tactics are to shoot people in the legs and run up and do the execution moves to them.
Mm-hmm. Like the sweep kick or whatever.
The sweep kick, and then you can totally suplex the dudes in the castle. It's amazing. I love it.
I never did that.
No?
In my first playthrough. I never ventured out to do that.
I have to do it every time now. It's one of those things. You got to suplex.
Well, it's once you get the confidence, you go through the game, then you're like, I can get in close. But like that first time, I was like, stay as far the fuck away from me as you
gotcha.
Can.
I love to suplex and then have their heads explode. That's a really nice bonus. I also am a big fan of shooting anybody in the legs with a shotgun or just anywhere, and they fly backwards, and then you can just run up and cut them with your knife. Big ammo saving tactic there. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, this game is all about gaming the system. It stars my favorite character in the Resident Evil universe, Leon Kennedy.
Okay.
I was going to... Who is your favorite?
I don't know if I even have a favorite. I like the Resident Evil games I've played.
Oh, yeah, you're not old gen like me.
No.
You started with 4.
I started with 4, yeah. Okay. I mean, I think I put some time into Resident Evil Code Veronica for a second on PS2.
That is the hardest of the Resident Evil.
That's what I heard. And it just didn't hook me. Like, I was playing Silent Hill, getting into that, so I was like, I'll go back to Resident Evil. Tried Code Veronica. It's like, it's not for me right now.
Code Veronica is, to this day, the only Resident Evil I've never beaten. In the main series. I mean, there's all the side shoots. But in the main run of them, Code Veronica is the only one I have never beaten.
I've missed 2 through Code Veronica. So 2, 3 in Code Veronica.
Well, and you only played 1 because of this podcast, right?
I had played maybe an hour or two of it. But it was the same thing. Like, the puzzles were frustrating me. And just the constant backtracking, like, immediately. And I was like, I don't need this right
now. I'm glad you brought up the puzzles. Because, well, you never played 2. But
I did
1.
Not, no.
1 you have played. And I just love that. I don't know if it's because they're puzzle games or if that's the way that the Japanese think that Americans really do handle security systems. And the fact that, like, you need to put 2 gems on opposite sides of a map into this statue to unlock the secret laboratory.
Yeah.
And that's really how we do things over here. We don't have passcodes or number screens or thumb scanners. It's all different colored gems into statue heads.
Well,
so they got that right. Way
to go.
This whole
theory, like their whole design theory is just like, for game only, we don't care if it makes sense. Like, I think you're right at the castle where like Ashley gets separated from you and like the spikes come up. And then there's just like a device on the wall that perfectly comes out like belt straps or holds her. It's like, why is that in the castle at all? Like, when would somebody ever use that? Who had the foresight to be like, oh, in 300 years when this president's daughter comes in at this exact moment, leans on that exact wall. So you got to fucking throw any logic out the window with these games. And so going back to favorite character, I don't have one because I think the story and characters are all kind of just dumb and garbage. Like, I enjoy playing the games. I'm not emotionally invested in any of them.
I am not emotionally invested in, and to try to convince yourself to be emotionally invested in Resident Evil is asinine.
I was more invested in like Gears of War 2 than any of the Resident Evils, and that's like a bunch of bro meatheads.
Yeah
I
think Gears 2 is the best Gears, though, if we want to split hairs here. So that's just
me. Really like 3, and I think 3 has the better horde mode.
Three, I couldn't even finish 3.
I think you were just burnt out.
It might have been that.
Because I think 3 beats it in set pieces and everything, except for, I'd say, maybe the emotion. But, like, you do so much in 3. Like, it's... Every mission is so very, very different from 1. And, like, there's always, like, another big set piece that outdoes 2, in my opinion. But if you are... If you have played 2, it might seem a little too familiar. So maybe that's part of it, too.
I can't remember why. I liked 1 a lot. I thought 2 was really good, too. And then, but yeah, I don't know. 3 just didn't grab me. I was done. Maybe not enough variation. I don't know. But we're not talking about Gears of War 3. We're going to talk about Resident Evil 4 and Resident Evil in general.
Yes.
So I think, again, you do have to throw everything out the window because the fucking president of the United States' daughter has been kidnapped in a Spanish European country. Am I correct here?
Yeah.
And they send 1 fucking guy. 1 guy. That is not how this would ever go down.
Unless it was like Kurt Russell as Snake Plissken.
Yeah. Oh, I would definitely want Snake Plissken to save my daughter. I'm totally into that. And he could do it. The only other person who could do it is Leon S. Kennedy.
Yeah. Or John McClane. I don't know.
Maybe early John McClane, not current John McClane.
He's blowing up airplanes with his thoughts now.
It's
like he's a fucking superhero.
He's goddamn.
He can still do it.
He's the fucking transporter, is what John McClane has been reduced to now.
I'd like to play that video game.
There's a transporter video
game? A transporter video game. I don't think there is one.
Oh.
It could be made and it could be done well.
I thought there was. You know, there's a Thing video game.
I just found that out. Yeah. And for like the Xbox PS2 era, right? Yeah.
So I'd be interested in checking out sometime.
I wouldn't mind. I've never played it. Unless it's horrible. Because like I couldn't stand like Resident Evil, the first one, tested my patience. And like that's a well-done version. I can't imagine playing a badly done version of that. So if the Thing was that, it might be like teeth-grindingly bad.
So you said Resident Evil, the first one, was bad.
No, no, not bad. Not bad. Well, I think it's a good game.
Yeah.
It's for a very specific type of gamer.
Fair enough.
I am not that type of gamer.
That's what I think separates 4 from the rest. Well, 4 makes it more accessible, I guess is the word.
Yeah.
It makes it easier for the average Joe to play. The puzzles are never as involved as they are in 1. Usually there's no backtracking. Almost.
Yeah.
It's a very linear game. You're always progressing.
Mm-hmm. I will just interrupt real quick to say, if you haven't already heard it, we did do a podcast on the first Resident Evil game.
Yeah. And if you're watching on YouTube, I will link that right here.
Bloop.
And if you're just listening on iTunes or wherever, I will also provide a link to that episode because I thought it was a pretty good one.
Yeah, it was.
I really enjoyed playing the remake back again, and playing it as Chris for my very first time was something it was cool to do that. I challenged myself, and I'm glad I did it.
Yeah, and there will be a lot of maybe Resident Evil talk that might not come up here. It's because we already covered
exactly.
it. So we're not going to do a lot of backtracking. So
with its
unlike Resident Evil,
yes. Except for this one, and
this one's really good. 5 about and moving 6 forward.
I will go ahead and say
I think 6 backtracks a lot if you've played 6.
I have not played 6. I've avoided 6. I've played 4 a shit ton. I've played 5 a shit ton. Mm-hmm. I've never played 6, although Nathan keeps trying to get me to, and I do own it.
It's good. It's not great, and that's the thing.
Is it better than 5? Because I don't think 5 is even that great. Like, 5 is such a giant step down from 4.
I'd say it's a lateral movement. So like, there are some things that are better, but some things that are
worse. So I can play
worse.
It, but it's nothing... Mm-hmm.
But 6, you're doing like 4 different storylines,
yeah,
and all
that.
Of the storylines like use similar set pieces and locations. So just because you're doing it from a different side, it still feels like backtracking when you get to like 1 scene and you're doing it 4 different times.
The one good thing 6 has going for it for me, it's got Leon again.
It has everybody pretty much from Resident Evil that you like.
I think it's Leon. Is Ada with him?
Yeah. Well, yeah. No, she's not with him. He has a new girl.
Okay.
Some Spanish lady who I can't remember her name. Ada has her own separate story with a generic soldier as the co-op partner.
Okay. And the generic soldier is not Wesker's son guy? Is
no,
he with
that's
Chris?
His own storyline. He's with a girl, and I can't remember who the
Who's
girl
Chris
is.
Who's Chris with?
Chris is with...
Is he with Claire? He's not with Sheva, which is a shame. I liked Sheva.
I liked Sheva too. I don't remember who he's with, but he's with somebody. I think it's actually two guys on that team. I don't remember.
Okay.
Because they're all pretty bland, generic new people. I like Sheva. I like Chris and Sheva. I love Resident Evil 5.
You're one of the rares.
Not a lot of people do. No. And it's because I've never played the campaign by myself. And I think that's why. I've played that campaign through several times with the co-op partner. And it is a ton of fun.
See, I've always played it. I've played that game at least three separate times to succession. And I've always done it with Nathan. And as we both know, Nathan really? Is a blast. Anyways, Nathan and I are both... There's two things we love. It's terrible Resident Evil games, and it's Metal Gear Solid. And we both talk about both of those all the time. But we've played five tons, and that's why he keeps wanting me to play six. Mm-hmm. I just haven't... I don't know.
I also think five has the best Mercenaries mode, by far. And it's... If we're talking about Mercenaries... It might be my favorite part of Resident Evil.
You're a big
them.
Fan of that style of gameplay anyways. The horde modes, the survive modes, go as far as you can style.
Well, and the co-op stuff too. Like it's fun pushing yourself with other people, like getting tactics and like working together as a team to see how far you can go. I love that.
Halo 3 had a horde mode too, which I really liked.
I don't remember what it was.
I can't remember the name either, but I do remember it had it. I think it was Halo 3.
Halo 3 might be the one I played the least amount of multiplayer for. It was right at that point where I was getting over things college people liked. Like, for 2 years, it's like, oh, everybody likes Family Guy. I'm fucking done with Family Guy. Like, I gotta get distance from it. Like, oh, everybody likes Halo. I gotta get fucking distance from it. And that was right when Halo 3 hit. So, that's the one I kind of know the least about and have played. So, I don't know about this multiplayer horde mode there.
If you could... go gay for a game, I would have gone gay for the Halo series. I was so into all of them. My God. Up until 3. And then I was done. Again, it's like Gears. I got the story that they wanted to tell me. What are you going to give me?
Just new set pieces.
I read the book. I read The Fall of Reach. I own The Fall of Reach for whatever fucking reason.
This is very curious to me. I know this is a tangent, but...
Okay, we've barely talked about Resident Evil 4 as is.
I can't believe you will sit there and defend Halo as a story, but you'll shit on Gears of War, because I think they're both bad stories. I don't think they're very good narratives. I think Halo, the first one, has that great twist with the Flood, and then that's it. Like, the rest of the series has been disappointing every installment. Like, I've not found a compelling narrative in that game. Since I liked Reach's narrative. Reach was actually a very good narrative.
Reach is good, and the book is really good too.
Yeah, that's it though. Like, I think 2 and 3 are not great, and then 4 and 5 are also not great.
And this is the problem. And here I will defend, and I guess explain a bit. It's also the problem. Like, Bungie has amazing world building and amazing lore. They are terrible at giving it to you, and that's the big problem with Destiny as well. Destiny is this huge, deep, immersive world, but if you don't go looking for the stuff, you're never going to know anything going on. And Halo 2 and 3 both, they get too big for their britches almost. They're throwing a lot of things at you that you have no idea what's really going on. And I think that's a problem. I will agree with you in their narrative and the way that they're giving it to you. Like, it gets convoluted and almost too full of itself.
It's because... I like how you put that. I think that's very true. It's like they are world builders. They are not storytellers. And that's exactly what it is. Like, I am fascinated by their characters and the worlds and like the races and all this.
All the backstory, all
but
that
like,
shit. Yeah.
Maybe that adds to the convolutedness because they're building this world and like it gets convoluted by like 5 or Halo 5 Guardians. Because like every new game you have to introduce like this new race. And how they are intertwined into this galactic war that has lasted for all. So every time you're getting essentially the same kind of villain, but with different backstory and different powers maybe or moves.
I can't defend 4 and 5 because those aren't Bungie anymore.
They're 343. And Bungie, they're the same. Like, they're the fucking same. Like, Halo 4 and 5 play just as good and, like, tell just as good a story as 2 and 3.
The problems with Bungie are the same problems that BioWare suffers from, is that...
Ooh.
Well, all the good people have moved on. Like, you're stuck with all the people that have contributed to the game, but they weren't the original people that brought this amazingness together. So it's like you and me coming in and writing a fan fiction of Friday the 13th. Just, you know, I'm not saying... But it's like... We get it, but we didn't create it. We have a different sort of love and appreciation for it.
Yeah.
So you're bringing different things to the table.
I agree and I disagree, because Bungie was, and actually most of the original team, like, lasted for that first trilogy. Some came back to Reach. Trilogy drops off. That's like saying, like...
I don't think the trilogy drops off.
I think it does. I think it's like the Matrix.
I love the ending when it. Mm. I think it should have stopped at 3. I love that conclusion that it gets to. It made me feel emotional, and a big part of that too is Marty O'Donnell and his musical score is fucking top notch. And he's not even at Bungie anymore.
You take Marty O'Donnell out of that, and those games have no emotion and no soul.
A big part, yeah.
And that's what it is, because like you're talking about the ending of 3, and I'll fucking be straight honest. Like, I have probably not played 3's story to completion since 2008, 2009. I can't even fucking tell you what happens at the end of 3. That's how little it resonated with me. Like, it just. It didn't leave a fucking blip, but I can tell you, like, anything from Mass Effect or Dragon Age, the BioWare comparison, or if we're going back to Gears of War, like, I can tell you the big points for Gears of War. Like, I can't do that with Halo 2 or 3. I know 2 ended very disappointing. It said, like, the war is going to begin, or, like, they came to Earth or something.
2 was... It's the struggle of the middle child in the trilogy.
And then you get the convoluted Arbiter brutes are coming now and their thing, and... You're right. It's like all set up, and then I found personally the setup or the payoff in 3 wasn't much of a payoff. So it was like, in all honesty, I'd say the Halo trilogy is 1-1 with the Matrix trilogy. With each one after, like, you're setting up promise and you never deliver.
I think for me it's 1 is the high, 2 is the low, 3 hits the middle ground. It's not as good as 1. It's not as bad as 2. But it gives you what you want it to give you.
I think most people agree with you on that one.
That's my looking at it. But how the fuck are we talking about Halo this episode is about Resident Evil 4? That was a hell of a tangent. Let's try to bring this shit back.
Horde mode. We off on Horde mode.
Is that what it was?
Mercenaries.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So Resident Evil 4. Holy shit. It starts off... Okay, so here's my first question. We're going to just... This fucking episode is scattered all over the place.
I think it needs
anyways.
To be scattered.
Yeah, that's fine. Is Resident Evil 4 a horror game?
That's a good question. No.
I don't think so either.
I don't think it is. I think it has horror movie trappings at certain points, and mm-hmm. I think there
especially
are...
Especially the beginning.
Yes, and that's my favorite part of the game is up until the barn fight with that boss, like, I think is a perfect horror game. And then, like, once you get to the castle and everything after that, like, it starts to get progressively more and more away from it. And I think, as we've talked about, Resident Evil 4 pivots away from Resident Evil, and this is why we end up with 6 the way it is. It's because of Resident Evil 4. So, no, I do not think it's a horror game. You seem to agree?
I do agree.
Yeah.
I think it has some horror elements, some horror tropes, but it's an action game wrapped in the deceitful cloak of horror.
And it's a really good action game.
Yes,
it is. It's a really good action game.
I think this is Shinji Mikami's swan song, especially for Capcom and the Resident Evil series. I think this is his last one.
It's his last Resident Evil, but he went on to...
he made Shadows of the Damned.
Which is fantastic if you've not played it.
Yeah, it's a really good game.
I love it. I think it's really good.
And it's got crazy, weird, absurdist humor, too.
It's that Grasshopper Studio, Suda51 humor and story. With Shinji Mikami's action gameplay for Resident Evil 4, perfect.
And again, I love it's got a really cool lore, like the fact that all your guns are based around the skull, and all of the bullets are his teeth.
Yeah,
that's really cool. It's a great concept, and the fact that he's talking to you the whole time, he's like your companion.
It's super cheesy and like really upset. Like I
remember fighting a giant goat boss that you shoot in the dick.
That's the thing is, like, I think the game is like super obsessed with sex and sexualization of different things, but, and like but, his His gun's called the Big Boner.
Yeah, it's about hell, and
it plays in.
Hell is a giant sexual deviant thing in certain cultures.
It's thematically perfect, and it works. But like, it is like the cheesy, over the top, wink, wink, nod, nod. We know what we're doing. But I think there is something deeper there with all the sexual nods. But it's just such a fantastic game.
Plus, it's deeply rooted in Satanism and hell, and fuck, I'm all about that all the time. I'm so into that. This game, Resident Evil 4, it's hard for me to like and love too, because this is also, this one takes a very, very sharp turn from the rest of the series in the fact that, like, this is not a genetically engineered bioweapon. This is all about an alien parasite.
Yeah.
Which has very strong hints of The Thing, which is something we'll talk about in the near future. But
I think you can see The Thing reflected in the design of the Las Plagas monsters,
Especially like that boss fight in the barn that you brought up, especially just is, it's like a fucking rejected monster from The Thing.
Now, as I have a question, since you have played the originals, in 2 or 3, did you ever see anything like the Las Plagas with like the tentacly, like body morphing thing kind of stuff? Or is that new for Resident Evil 4 going on?
It's new in the fact that all the enemies in this game look like humans and then can modify after enough damage is done. In 1, 2, and 3 Resident Evil, it's generally they're zombies.
Yeah.
Or completely leapers or other mutated monsters.
Yeah.
There is the main character in, or the main villain in Resident Evil 2 is a guy who, as the game goes on, is morphing into different monster, and you fight him a couple times and he's in different form before he reaches his ultimate form. But it's more based on the tyrant aspect, and it's not so alien-esque. It's just, it's more like Akira almost.
Okay.
Like
okay.
when he's growing into a big blob and getting all of these weird things to happen. So this one is definitely, they do make it different and unique, which I applaud them.
And memorable.
Yeah.
Very memorable.
I remember the first time one of those fuckers pops out of somebody's head. It's something until you realize how easily you can kill them if you are prepared, which the flash grenades kill them all in one hit. I don't know if you're aware of that. I'm sure you are. Most people who have played it more than one time are.
Just know. Yeah.
Yeah.
And this was back on the GameCube. So this was Game Facts, Strategy Guy, learning all the tips and tricks.
Going on those message boards. I remember those days.
Yep, uh-huh.
I also really like, you can get an idea of who's going to turn, I think, on at the nighttime when they have the red glowing eyes. I thought that was a nice touch. Yeah, I mean, it's a fun game. It does great things, but it's also a little forgettable, like...
How so?
Well, and like as you said before we started recording, the last 20% almost becomes a blur where it starts to mold into this Call of Duty. Excuse me, I belched there. This it's like this mashup where all the Las Plagas that you've been fighting suddenly are soldiers with guns and AK-47s, and they're shooting you as you're trying to shoot them, and it's all this, again, I'm sure it was something to do with budget and timing, having to get a gun out where, or a game out, I'm sorry, where it's just, they're rapidly ramping you towards this conclusion, and then you have a boss fight, and then there's the final runaway chase, and ta-da.
Yeah. Which, I mean, that runaway chase was right after Devil May Cry. I think it's like very similar almost.
Yeah, and it's Capcom made Devil May Cry too. Yeah,
well, Devil May Cry was originally going to be a Resident Evil game.
That's right. Have you ever seen the concept art for Resident Evil 4 or the concept builds where you were Leon still, but you were actually like getting chased by like a blue spirit almost? I always thought those looked really cool, and I would like to have seen what happened with that.
Yeah, it would have been a very, very different game. And just think, if that's what we got, where would we be now? Would we have like Resident Evil 7, a remake in first person now to right the wrongs of 4, 5, and 6?
Yeah, and I think that's what they are trying to do with 7 is they get that they've strayed away from what makes Resident Evil Resident Evil. Like, it's not horror anymore. It's an action game.
Yeah. Are you excited about that? Are you excited about Resident Evil 7?
I don't know if I'd say excited. Yeah. I'm cautiously optimistic.
Okay.
Can you say?
Okay.
So I have hope.
I'm pessimistic. I'm doom and gloomy about this.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm giving him benefit of the doubt because of the amazingness that was the PT demo. I don't know if you ever played PT.
Well, that was Konami. And that's exactly. What I think. And
it's a different thing, but it's still a first person horror experience.
That's why I am pessimistic about this, is because that PT demo was released. It became a thing. Everybody loved it, went crazy for it. And then I think Capcom was like, whatever we have in Resident Evil, scrap it. We're doing this. And so I think we're going to get a rushed, not great game that is just trying to piggyback on that PT rush.
I actually argued this exact same point with Nathan.
But I think that's it.
That's exactly what I felt that they were doing. They saw that the buzz that PT generated and wanted to try to get something in going on that. It could be cool. I like the idea that they're doing VR with it.
Yeah.
But it also could be gimmicky.
Still not sold on VR. Sorry, Dan.
Yeah, I'm not totally at the either. But it is. It's hitting a more mainstream market. I think the PlayStation VR has launched.
It did just today, Tuesday. Or is it today? I knew it was this week. Yeah.
So that's out, and I think that having it on the PlayStation will make it more accessible to everybody, if nothing else. So we'll see.
But will people pay $500 for a new PS?
I think the VR, the benefits of VR are easily the most glaring in horror and pornography.
Yeah, and you never hear anything being talked about pornography wise.
I've seen something like at game shows. They have some hentai games that people are playing, and it looks very awkward because they're playing a sex game in VR in public. And it's very weird, but yeah.
There's got to be so much like dissonance going on if you're doing virtual reality porno or something. Like, because you look everywhere, right? Yeah. So you look down, and let's say you're masturbating to like this really hot 3D virtual porn, right? But like you look down, and there's no dick. Then do they have to animate a dick so you can see?
I would think so.
And then is it going to be a really crude hand? How are they going to know your dick size? It's weird. I don't know. I think it falls apart. I think porno is not going to go into VR. I think VR is going to shit the bed because of that.
No, I think porno will go into VR, and VR will be huge because of it. Anything porno attaches to becomes the one.
Yeah, that's a Blu-ray and DVD because
VHS over Beta.
Mm-hmm, so. That's right. No Laserdisc. They skipped that. They didn't go HD DVD.
They went Blu-ray. So and the internet, man. The internet is huge because of porno.
Yeah. Well, I mean, right. Yeah.
I mean, not just because of it, but by God, that's a huge contributing factor.
Here's the thing. And this is why porn will not jump to VR, not for at least 5 to 10 years, is because your average porn goer just hops on the internet. That's a free thing. How do you convince that porn goer to pay like $800, $900 for an Oculus Rift or a Vibe to jump in and do virtual porn? You have to like convince them. And then how do you convince them? You have to set up a kiosk of porn at porn conventions? That's not going to be enough. I don't think you can.
No, I think that VR is going to... People are going to get it for games. And then the added benefit of there's virtual reality porno is going to be like, well, fucking A, I got the headset already.
Yeah.
What's the deal here?
I'd say gamers are not a big enough draw in the porn markets, but
there was
that study that Pornhub released that when Fallout 4 was released, they hit record low numbers at the time.
Yeah.
So maybe gamers are like the porn. Maybe you're right.
I think you're right. We'll see where it goes.
Resident Evil 4.
This game has great atmosphere, and it's something I noticed today when I was playing it. I played it yesterday and today. It does a really great job with the music too, of letting you know what you should be feeling. There are some times where there's a bit of an uneasy feeling going on. It tends to get shark jumpy, I guess. There was the scene I was playing today in the castle where of course you're fighting all of the cultists and you're chasing one cultist that is shown to have a key around his neck, and it's letting you know you need that key. And as you aim at him, he runs away behind a corner. And as you chase him around this corner, he runs out a door. And as you continue to chase him, he comes out of the middle of the fucking room on a giant chain gun. And then it's just this super awkward, annoying fight for that kills all this crazy momentum that you had going.
Yeah.
But then you've got other scenes like the where you're fighting the giant fish thing in the lake. That's a pretty fucking iconic battle. Yeah. And when the scream that he has at when he's coming at you is pretty cool. And it's very Moby Dick-esque where you're really just throwing harpoons at this fucking thing.
Yeah.
We touched on the barn boss fight, which has crazy elements of the thing going on with the barn burning around you. And this dude who's already a giant imposing figure doubles his height because like his torso detaches from his hips and he grows this crazy weird spine.
It's you're right. It's directly out of the thing. I'd say the first boss fight with the cave troll. I'm just going to call it the Lord of the Rings cave troll because that's what it is.
El Gigante.
Oh, that's right.
And there are multiple fights with El Gigante.
Well, it's like the Capcom thing where, this boss is now just a normal guy for you to fight, like, later on the game.
Yeah, you fight one, and then you fight another one with Ashley, and then later on, again, you fight two.
Two. I was like, no, two, no, it's four. Yeah, no, it's
you fight two in a giant lava pit, and one of them is in BDSM gear for some reason.
Yeah, it's weird.
You fight El Gigante in five as well, on the back of that car.
Which is good.
A very annoying, it's the second most annoying boss fight when you're playing the hardest mode. The most annoying boss fight in the entire game, of course, being the Jill fight. God, that fight is awful, especially on professional difficulty. But what else is there's El Gigantes. I would consider the first guy, like you said, they become normal enemies as the game progresses, but the chainsaw guy.
Yeah.
The first boss, pretty iconic.
Very so iconic that they made a PlayStation 2 controller that was a chainsaw.
Did they actually?
Did you ever play with that?
I did not. No.
Man, I wish I knew somebody who did. I saw it for like $10 used at and I didn't get it.
God, that was a fuck few up, years man. Ago.
I know.
You really should have got that.
I was like, I'll never use it. It's just gonna sit on my shelf.
Exactly. That's all it is for.
I don't know. I just didn't need it at the time.
Those guys are crazy weird. They have the sack on the head like the original Jason Voorhees. It's a nod to that. Again, this game is a big nod to a lot of horror tropes and things of the 80s and 90s. It's a lone person put up against impossible situations that eventually overcomes them. I think it's more evident here than in all the other Resident Evils. So... your only real partner is, I can't even remember his fucking
Luis?
Name. Yeah, Luis. Ada shows up a couple times, but never really does anything.
Well, she's like the Molotov cock tease. Like, she's not on your side, and she'll help you sometimes, but she won't help you always, and she has her own agenda.
There's that will they, won't they with Ada.
It is. It's Brock and Molotov cock tease.
And that's been established since Resident Evil 2. She was.
I didn't know that, but he brought up Resident Evil 2 and Raccoon City specifically, so I figure that's a question then. I can't remember the last guy's name, but like the big army man who works for
Wesker? Wesker's in the end of this game.
Salazar is the midget.
Yeah.
And then Sadler, who works for Sadler.
Lord Sadler.
And then he has like a former STARS member who's like a big buff army dude. That guy, Krauser.
Yeah, Krauser. He's not from STARS guy. No, he's completely new for this. I think he was like somebody Leon knew in Special Forces in between 2 and 4.
Oh, okay, because he was like, I thought you died in the helicopter crash. I was like, am I missing this? Like, no. Is this from the previous game?
Krauser's never even been mentioned before 4.
Okay,
so,
okay.
The one thing that I think this game does awful is fucking quick time events. And you bring up Krauser.
Interesting you say that. Krauser does a lot of quick time events.
And that's what really kills it. And there's a lot of them that just are momentum killers because they're so quick. And if you hit the wrong one, like the rock can crush you and things like that. That I'm not a fan of quick time events almost any time. And I think they kill the flow of a game. They can make it more cinematic until they don't work. And then,
I'm very curious to talk about our game in 2 weeks.
Yeah?
But
oh, yeah, I know.
I kind of like them here. And I did look it up because I was very curious, because God of War is usually credited with like being the first at QuickTime events. But I was like, I think that's wrong. I think Resident Evil was the first one to do QuickTime events.
Is it
like
a big thing? First?
And it was. It is. It predated God of War by like 3 or 4 months.
Okay.
Like this came out in January of whatever year it came out, and like God of War was in March or April. So, because I remember like the cutscenes, like everybody was like, oh man, and you can't put your controller down during these cutscenes because you'll get these quick time events.
Yeah,
and like
you hear that coin
being phrased now. And I kind of like them in the cutscenes. I don't like them as much in the game when they pop up.
Right, and like in the boss fights, and they're all over Resident Evil 5. I know. And the ending when you're fighting Wesker, there's so fucking many.
Oh, when you punch a fucking boulder. How horrific is that? Yeah. How Resident Evil is that?
Yeah.
You're punching a boulder.
It jumps the goddamn shark so bad. But
By that said, I think it's so ridiculous. Like, I kind of love it. It's like the Batman and Robin of the Resident Evils. I kind of like it in spite of itself.
Yeah. It's Resident Evil 4 is a great game. It is not a horror game. But it has some nice horror elements. Yeah. There are some points that'll put you on the edge of your seat, but overall, it's not scary.
Yeah, that's fair.
Outside of the very first time you ever meet a regenerator. I think those things are fucking creepy, and they're off put. They have that grin.
Yeah.
And they are completely antithetical to everything else you've fought up to this point, because you could shoot something in the legs. And you shoot this thing in the legs, and its legs blow off, and you're like, oh, that's fucking cool. I've not seen anybody's legs actually get blown off yet. Mm-hmm. And then it starts crawling towards you, and then you notice that the legs grow back. And then you're like, what the fuck? How do I stop this fucking thing? And I like that how you do stop them. It's like an X-ray.
You do like a thermal scope.
Yeah.
And then you have to hit like the 4 Las Plagas on them. There's like 3 in the front and 1 on the back, I think. They're really... really well designed. I think some of the bosses are creepy to scary how they're designed. I know like that final boss, like he starts to transform and like the giant eyeball comes out of his mouth.
And that's a nod to Resident Evil 2.
Oh, is it? Okay. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know that, but I was like, that's a fucking disturbing image, that giant eyeball.
Because Resident Evil 2's guy, it's a different virus in Resident Evil 2 than in Resident Evil. I believe Resident Evil is the T virus.
I don't even know.
And Resident Evil 2 is the G virus. And the guy from Resident Evil 2 was, him and Wesker were like partners. Yeah. They developed their weapons at the same time, but they diverged. And so that's why you have like the liquors and everything, because his changes things more on like the under the skin level. But he has eyeballs that start growing on him everywhere, and it's really odd. And he has this huge one on his shoulder.
That's kind of cool.
There's a big eye theme in Resident Evil 2. A thing I really like in Resident Evil 4 is you can actually unlock the Raccoon City Police Department uniform Leon wears.
A big nod to 2.
Yeah. Well, you have to beat the game once, but it's cool. I like that. It gives you incentive to play through again. I did it. You can get the Chicago typewriter, which is it's pretty much game-breaking. But I don't know. I don't really have much else to say about Resident Evil 4. Again, we're not treading new ground with this one. It's a fun game. I don't know anybody that plays games regularly that hasn't played this game already.
That's true. Yeah, if you're a gamer, you've probably played it. At the very least, you've heard of it. And if you've heard of it and not played it, like there are so many ways to do it in high definition at 60 frames per second. It's going to look good. You can do that. I recommend doing that.
It's on Steam, I think, for like... $10, if that, right?
Oh, there. I feel like on PSN at the very least, there's like a Capcom weekly deal like every month.
Yeah,
I feel like I see Resident Evil 4 HD and Origins and all that like on sale for super discounts.
And again, like we talked about with American Werewolf, this game really sort of influenced games after it. To a point, like
third-person shooting again. I fucking love third-person shooting
over the shoulder. The quick time events, for good or bad, those are a big staple of a lot of games nowadays. So yeah, I love this game. It's one that you can play through now myself. You know, I can tear through it pretty quickly. It's enjoyable. It's never not at least fun. It's cool to shoot people in the face, and you get some cool weapon upgrades and things like that. There's some different ways you can play through it too. I generally rely on one handgun and the shotgun and just kind of tear through that way. It's really all you need, but you can do other things. So, yeah. What about you?
I really like it. It's not, it would never be in contention for one of my favorite games of all time. I've enjoyed it every single time I played it. I have not a lot of bad things to say about it. But
it's like pepperoni pizza. It's not your favorite food, but by God, you won't say no to it.
I don't know. Pepperoni pizza might be my favorite food.
God it's damn. Well, that's not mine, but that's me. But you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's not the best thing in the world, but by God, it's always enjoyable.
I mean, it's arguably one of the best Resident Evil games, but I would never put the Resident Evil games as one of my favorites, any of them.
Yeah.
And that's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing at all. It's just different things for different people, but it just never lasted or connected with me or stuck with me. Like, there are games I play, and like all I can think about is playing that game more, and like I can't break away. I fucking dream games at sometimes. Like, I've played like sessions of games where like the fucking bars and numbers are like in my fucking dreams.
I've had that problem. Yeah,
this game just never did that for me.
Yeah,
it's
very, a nice warm bath.
Very similar comparison. Dead Space series, right? Dead Space connected with me, and like I would even say like I enjoyed the first two Dead Spaces more than this. And that's why cool. Is that? I don't know, but yeah, like it just hit that right spot.
Totally disagree with you. I don't like Dead Space.
I think
at
most
all.
People would. I think most gamers would say like Resident Evil 4 is tops of any type of that game, but
it's definitely, and it deserves the respect that it has. It's definitely earned it. But yeah I agree with you. It's nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, it is an amazing feat, but again, it's so, I don't know if it's, again, maybe that's because of its influence on everything else that it seems so blasé now, but
you say it's blasé, but I still think it has some very memorable characters. Like,
oh yeah,
Salazar, like he's like my go-to villain. It's either Wesker from Resident Evils or it's Salazar. Like, I don't remember anybody else.
I like his two minions that are hinted at.
Yeah,
many times they're like these weird bug things that you do eventually end up fighting, but they have this menacing presence all throughout
their cloaks, and you can just see like the little incisor
the predator
thing,
mandibles.
Yeah.
It's a really nice touch, and you know that you're going to fucking fight those things at some point.
All right, so this guy, this little guy is like Napoleon, but he's like 20 years old, so I guess he's like, you know, Webster or Gary Coleman, essentially. He's like the Spanish Gary Coleman.
Stunted by the Las Plagas.
Yeah,
or
right?
Something, yeah.
But he's like made a giant robot statue that follows you at one point, like fucking it's, done. Like, that's super memorable. Like,
it's,
that's cool.
It's really a wild thing.
But it's like very schlocky and very different from 1-3.
Yeah.
Resident Evil 4 to the Resident Evil series is what Army of Darkness is to the Evil Dead series.
Absolutely.
And that's gonna,
perfect comparison.
That's going to temper how you like it.
So apt. Mm-hmm. Very nice. I think that's the perfect place to end. You did it all right there. So. I would recommend you play Resident Evil 4. That's what I will say on it.
Yeah, I think it still holds up today. You can play it. I recommend it.
All right. Well, that's all I got to fucking say. Again, we didn't tread anything new here. If you've played Resident Evil 4, you know all this stuff. But I hope you enjoyed listening to it.
Talk about porn.
There's all kinds. This episode was everywhere. So I was actually kind of enjoyed this one.
Yeah.
I give cheers to you, my friend.
Sometimes we ramble more, and that was this episode. Whatever.
This has been the Resident Evil 4 episode, guys. Thank you for listening, and we'll catch you at the next Halloween special. Bye.
Hi, this is Ryan, and if you liked what you just saw or listened to, please check us out at experiencegrind.com. Find us on facebook.com/experiencegrind, at Twitter, over at twitter.com/expgrindpodcast, where Kyle's tweeting out a lot of stuff all the time. And then you can always find us, our podcast, on iTunes, Stitcher, Twitch, or even on YouTube. Find us, just search Experience Grind Podcast. We don't have a channel yet. Stuff super easy to find. But please subscribe. We'll get there to you, make it even easier. And as always, if you like what you saw, we cover many games and episodes every week. There's sure to be something you love. And as always, grind out.